Hi everyone. Oops, one second. Rookie mistake. Hope everyone's well. I'm not looking at the chat yet. I'm a little bit disorganized because, of course, I'm impulsively going live. Just want to make sure everyone can hear me. Hi. Hi, everyone. Hi, Sam. Stephanie. Hi. Hi, Hattie. Okay, I'm just trying to get everything ready. I have some things to show you, some exhibits, if you will. Let me just see where they went. All right, so here I am again talking about the Watts case. So I want to just get that out of the way first. I did say that I'm done, and I am. I haven't done any research, any studying, any reading about it, nothing. Haven't really been keeping up with the lives. I'll pop in here and there, but overall I just gave up. But I do want to come in every now and then when I see the train kind of going off tracks, if you will. So, because the thing that I think a lot of us want in this case is the truth, but it seems like that's one of the things that is also causing most of the conflicts everywhere. This case is affecting people's lives who shouldn't be affected. And at least not in a way of what's happening with the online. Thank you, SoCal. Thank you. Thank you, Nine Share. I'm sorry, I suck at pronouncing. Yeah, so we want the truth, and the longer that we are sent down rabbit holes and wild goose chases, the farther away from truth will we get. So why I thought it was important for me to come live tonight is because I can already see a lot of the YouTube stuff and the direction that it's heading in terms of the Oxy and what Ms. Cadle is saying, even though in her book, she has clearly stated that Chris has acted alone. There's no other investigations. There's no other accomplices. There's nothing to see here. And, you know, of course, now she's feeding AD a lot of, you know, a lot of these quote unquote clues that she didn't have before when she first wrote her book. So, you know, now all of a sudden there's going to, not only are there accomplices, but now there's also going to be arrests, according to Ms. Cadle. And I can see where it's heading because this is exactly where it went last time. 2 years ago when we all had this conversation about the Oxy. And I was personally interested in that because I thought that Chris, there's indications in the discovery that Chris did try to poison Shanann. And in my opinion, I think that whatever he intended to do with the Oxy was not to cause a miscarriage, because that's not why people give people opiates. I believe that while he was in North Carolina, he probably wanted to induce an accidental overdose. And I think that he thought that he could get away with it. And that it's convenient in North Carolina because he's there with the girls. So the girls could stay with the grandparents and he could just go back and live his bachelor life with his girl. So I think that failed. And I think a second attempt was made then the last weekend of Shanann's life when she went to Arizona. I believe that on that Friday night or Friday, early Saturday morning, I believe that he placed or put some oxys inside of her balance pills for Thrive. So that was like the theory that I was working off of. And so far, I think that I still kind of believe that that's what happened. So way back when we started looking into this, we had no idea about Thrive and we had no idea about what the Thrive pills look like and what if you could even put pills inside of anything, like what the way would be of him doing that. Because I guess part of the Thrive system are shakes that you have to drink. I think it's like once a day or however many times a day, but shakes are part of like the three-step system. And, you know, one of the theories could be that he put it in one of her shakes. But then for the Arizona trip, he could have put it inside of her Thrive stuff so that, you know, she could, it could look accidental. So what we did is we, one of our mods is a Thriver. So we asked her to show us what the Thrive pills look like and if we can if there was a way of putting something inside of them. So I'm going to play those videos for you guys. Just 1 second, let me figure this out. Exactly, first truth seeker, exactly. I'm so glad you bring that up because it definitely it's going to come up in the Kurt Cobain series as well, because opiates are definitely a major part of the of that story anyways. Okay, so let me see. I hope you can hear what I'm about to share. So like I said, this is one of our mods and she is a Thriver. So we asked her to show us what Thrive looks like and if we can, not obviously us, but if it would be possible to hide Oxy inside of Thrive pills. So so that's the first one. And then, well, actually, that was the second one. But this is the first one, originally the first one now. I don't know what I'm talking about, guys. But you'll get the point when I get to it. So Thrive has different kinds of pills, I guess. So we were just looking at the ones. So Shanann had the balance pills that were the capsules that she just showed us. And then there's another vitamin pill. Stop. And if you remember, Shanann had a pink vitamin pack next to her bed. So These would be more obviously difficult to hide oxygen because they're sealed, but Whoa. Okay, so that was a other type of pill, I guess, that Thrive comes in. So in my opinion, the balance pills, they're not sealed. They come in a little container. There's a bunch of them in there. He could have easily hidden something in there. So yeah, is it plausible? Yes. Now, the other part of this, I'm just trying to figure out. One second. I'm really sorry. I'm just trying to figure out how to slow down the chat. So, give me 2 seconds as if I knew what I was doing, but. All right. I'm still looking for for chat slowdown. Sorry, guys. Oh. Yeah, I cannot find it right now for the life of me. So I apologize for that. Go figure. Let me try one more thing. I'm sorry, guys. I know it's frustrating when the chat is like really fast, and I also get distracted easily, so. But anyways, so with the oxy, so that was kind of like how we started trying to figure out what the deal is with that. And it didn't take long before we ended up in a rabbit hole where we were looking at Chris's sister, Jamie, because there had been some rumors and some thoughts, and how it goes in true crime. We never leave any stones unturned. And there had been some talk and some rumors about possibly him getting the oxy from Jamie, which I didn't know. I didn't know Jamie at the time, and I didn't know what she was like. I didn't know the type of person she was. Didn't really know much about her because they didn't even interview them. They didn't interview them during the investigation. So it was kind of like it could be anything. There's a limited information. So 1 second. I'm still trying to find the chat thing, but it's not. So I'm just gonna. I don't know where it is. If anyone else can figure it out, please, please do. But I have no idea how to do it. So let me share my other screen now. Okay, can you guys see this? I hope so. So then I kind of started working on a little timeline for myself to track the Oxy. That's kind of in how I develop theories is like I just track it, retrace the steps and find out where the source is. So as we know, the Oxy was in the discovery as a Google search that Chris did. We don't know when, we don't know where, and we don't know the date or the time. So then the Oxy is mentioned in Chris's letter to Cadle, which was first published in the Daily Mail. And Chris says, the reason the medical examiner found OxyContin in Shanann's system is because I gave it to her. I thought it would be easier to be with Nicole if Shanann wasn't pregnant. Cadle asked him about the claims that Watts gave his wife, this is from the Daily Mail article, that Watts gave his wife oxycodone. And he responded with conflicting stories, saying that he had given it to her twice, once at her parents' home in North Carolina to try to cause a miscarriage, and then immediately before her death. He later contradicted himself and said he only gave it to her once in North Carolina. I asked him where he got the Oxy, and he told me that is one of the things that he will take to his death, Cadle wrote. So that's where it first kind of came up. And obviously with him saying that he's going to take it to his death, you know, that immediately caused speculation. And it was either, oh, it must have been a family member, or it must be NK. But it's definitely someone that he's trying to protect. And I think that's kind of where the rumor started. Yeah, and this is an interesting thing about this is that even Chris himself gets it wrong because he says the reason the medical examiner found OxyContin, the medical examiner didn't find OxyContin in Shanann's system. We saw the toxicology results and there is no OxyContin. So, and at this time of this letter, Chris did not have a copy of the discovery, so he had no idea what was even in the discovery, which is why people like, you know, certain individuals, it was easy for them to fill his head because he has no clue what is even contained in those 2,000 pages and then the gigabytes and gigabytes of digital stuff. So people were coming at him. At one point, there were people correcting him. Like he would get asked a question and then he would get corrected saying like, no, actually in the discovery, it says this. Like, so I'm pretty sure that the way that the sentence is written and knowing how Chris is concrete, not very communicative, not very social, whatever. So this sounds like a response to a question that Cadle probably posed to him. So yeah, I agree, Francesca. Oxy is not the issue in this case, period. So well, let me just see. Yeah, Oxy doesn't remain in your system for that long. Then the next time the Oxy thing came up was in Cadle's book. I just searched the term Oxy and copied kind of everything that came up. So she said, the first night Christopher arrived to North Carolina, Shanann needed something for a really bad headache. Christopher told her he would get her something. Thinking she was taking an over-the-counter pain reliever, he gave her an 80 milligram of oxycodone. He said the pill, I don't even think that oxycodone, like 80 milligrams of oxycodone would be multiple pills. I don't know, though. He said the pill, obviously one, made her sick, and Shanann was up vomiting most of the night. He didn't help her because he wanted her to lose the baby. He felt he had given her a large enough dose to miscarry. So, yeah. The next time it came up, it was, again, he says, the first night I was there, we were at Shanann's parents' house. So that's allegedly the same night that he gave her the oxy. I texted Nikki and told her that I would not be able to call her, only text with her. And that's allegedly when Nikki was like, why are you with her? So that's also, he says, the first night I was there was the first night I gave Shanann the oxycodone. Now he says codon. I thought it would cause her to have a miscarriage. I'd looked it up on the internet and read about it, and 80 milligrams of oxycodone should have caused her to lose the baby. More like, what? Like, I've never seen that. If you Google, will 80 milligrams of oxy cause a miscarriage, you're going to get a no, that it's very rare. We have babies born on addicted to opiates because it usually doesn't. Yeah. MT, yeah, I'm not back on the case. That's what I was saying in the beginning. I'm here to clear, or just put my side, I guess, out here. Who knows what he meant? Obviously, he's not very bright. Like, I feel like this is kind of the idea that I get from Chris. I get the idea that if you ask him a question, he can't just give you a simple yes or no. Like, he has to give you some sort of story. So, okay, so then last year in October, a source close to the family was requesting for True Crime Rocket Science to address the oxy. So this family source said that Chris doesn't remember the exact date, but the oxy search was done before his visit to North Carolina. They, meaning Chris and Shanann, had expired medications all throughout the bins down in the basement to include the painkillers. Shanann was into couponing and would get good deals on medication. So in those bins downstairs, they had both prescriptions and over-the-counter medication. That's why there's so much of it. I don't know if I believe that. Opiates are a controlled substance, and you can't hoard opiates. Like, it doesn't make sense. So whoever this source is for the family, I don't know if this is, like, it makes no sense. They also had them in the medicine cabinet. He is unclear about which he used, but we assume he could have scraped up whatever he found. He then crushed them and put them in her Thrive Balance pills and already had them made and ready to give to her in Colorado. He gave it to her in North Carolina. He's saying he only gave it to her once in North Carolina when he had first arrived. He has only ever told any of us that it was once. Given it to her twice, as he stated, in that letter was news to us. He currently maintains that he only did it once. So confusing and terribly frustrating to have these conflicting accounts. I did speak with XXX by phone just before I emailed you to make sure I've understood it just right. Also, he's going to be reading the book soon and going through it to separate facts from lies. And then True Crime Rocket Science also posted a video, which I'm going to link below, but I'm also going to show you what Chris said. If I could just figure this out. One second. Okay. Where's StreamYard here? Too many things going on here. All right, so this is True Crime Rocket Science. Let me see. Let me know if you can hear it.
It was in the bin. It was in the medicine bin at home. It was me. It was either July 30th or 31st, whatever was the first day I got in North Carolina. I booked in Colorado. It was with me when I went on the plane.
All right, so that's that. Okay, so we have Chris on tape saying that it was all him, it was me, it was me, it was me. But now here we are yet again, a year later. Now we're starting to talk about the Oxy again. So at that time when this whole Oxy thing was going on, of course, we started questioning the possibility of Chris getting the Oxy from possibly his sister. So when Jamie and I started talking, I kind of established from the beginning that this is the type of person that I am. Like, I strive for transparency. Like, I'm not good at reading between the lines. I'm kind of, you know, just be direct with me. Like, and if I have questions, I'll come to you. If you have questions, you come to me. So we kind of immediately established that kind of understanding. And in order to address all of those rumors, because I was so tired of just all the secondhand stories. Everybody was talking for everybody. And frankly, like at the beginning of my relationship with Jamie, we didn't start off on like good terms. Like we started off rocky, you know, because I had very strong opinions about, well, it's a long story, but about all the quote unquote spokespeople that the Watts had. So, you know, I've always been kind of loud in my opinions. So that was kind of how our relationship started from the beginning. It was just be straightforward with me, no lies, no BS, and no backstabbing, any of that stuff. And that was cool. So anytime I had a question about anything, I went directly to Jamie, and she has done, and I told her too that at this point, words to me don't mean a lot. So unless we can get receipts for the things that we're talking about, you know, it's not really gonna mean much to me. So we addressed all the rumors that were going around. So when the Rusecks bombarded Armchair Detectives Live asking to read the email. But the email that they had sent him was an email saying that Jamie has given Chris the Oxy. That's when I was like, all right, now this is getting weird. So I did. I went directly to Jamie and I said, we need to talk. And I said that, you know, why would people be accusing you of this? Like, what's the story here? So we talked about it. I obviously am not going to share any screenshots because I think that I promised Jamie that our conversations would remain private. And quite frankly, it's not for me to share. I'm just sharing you my opinion of what I gathered from Jamie. So when I asked her about the Oxy and she told me her side of the story and she denied ever giving Chris any Oxy, she doesn't even have a prescription for Oxy and she has never given him any Oxy and there was never any story about any Oxy. And when we asked her about how can we get some receipts for that, you know, is there any time at any point in your entire life that you could have given him something for pain, let's say, and that someone could have twisted it and turned it into this big deal? Like, where would this come from? And she says that she believes that this rumor with the Oxy started with Sherilyn Cadle, and that she has never given Chris any Oxy, and this is ridiculous. And she was willing to share with us her entire like phone contents to prove her innocence. And so that was kind of the road that we went down with her. And I appreciate Jamie for being open to that, because who are we? No one. We're strangers. And she, first of all, didn't have to even entertain anything as far as me asking her questions. Some of the things that I've asked her in the past that are related to the case, and not just to the case, but even just random questions, they're pretty intimate questions. They're pretty private questions. And so, you know, the fact that this is a public case and that this is a circus as it is and so many people are involved, you know, it's kind of like a new thing for everybody involved. Like, this is my first time ever dealing with this kind of thing. You know, that I'm confident that none of the family members have ever dealt with something like this. So this is all new for everybody. And we all make mistakes. We all do different things or whatever. But the point is that, you know, some of the questions that I'd asked her were pretty intimate and private. And she shared them, you know, she shared them with me and she had no reason to. So at the end of my overall assessment, I think that the Oxy is, first of all, insignificant to the murders, because there was no Oxy found in the system, and there's literally nothing. There's no evidence. If there are any phone records or phone receipts, we tried to get them, but we didn't get them. But if someone has them, you know, by all means, like if there is anything to indicate otherwise, then I would encourage those individuals, including Sherilyn, to go to the police, to report this to the police, and to let them do their job. But unless these people with 100% proof, you know, don't do that. And for example, you know, going around on Armchair Detective and like pretending like this is some sort of game is not healthy, and it's causing a lot of harm, not only to the Rusaks for having to listen to this all over again, but also the Watts, who are also victims in this case. And I get that Kim is right now, well, she's a thing on her own, but as for, that's a whole other story, which I don't even, I've actually invited Kim to come on a panel with me if she would like to discuss some of her little theories, but we'll see. I haven't received a response yet. But the point of this is that there's a lot of craziness going around in this case, and it's frustrating that, you know, someone whose credibility is very, very questionable, and their word is being taken as if it's, I don't know, as if it's set in stone. Why would anybody believe anything? And quite frankly, you know, listening, obviously Blair appears to be a real person. And obviously Blair, it appears that she is in contact with Chris Watts. And it's obvious that Kim is also in contact with Chris Watts. And it's obvious that he's telling different stories to different people. So listening to some of the letters that Armchair read out tonight, I was thinking like, oh my God, is Chris like losing touch with reality? Is he like psychotic or something? You know, I'm not obviously diagnosing him or anything, but it's so bizarre that he is now allegedly like giving all these codes. It's turning into Da Vinci's code or something. But then Kim has a recording of him saying that he wants something to do with, you know, so this is what happens. This kind of chaos is what happens when you literally, okay, so here, let me give you an example. During one of my training experiences, I worked at a hospital for the mentally ill, and there were a few individuals who had some sort of schizophrenia. So there was a lot of paranoia and that kind of behavior, and a lot of symptoms of psychosis. And I'll never forget my experience with learning about delusions and just how powerful delusions are. They truly are a fixed false belief that is resistant to logic. It's resistant to rationality. It's resistant to medications. So it's very bizarre. It's very weird. And but the thing about delusions is there's always a little bit, like there's a little bit of, it's rooted in some reality. So that's why when sometimes, you know, in movies, when you see paranoid schizophrenia depicted, you know, a lot of the conspiracy stuff, you know, it sounds insane, but it's not impossible because there is that root in reality. And this is kind of like, I find myself living in terms of like Watts Island. I feel like Watts Island is, we're all stuck in like this shared psychosis, and we're all following, running down leads from someone who's not in touch with reality. So this would be literally like if I'm working with someone suffering with paranoid schizophrenia, and they're telling me about the CIA planting and doing lobotomies in the basement of the White House. That would be like me going, oh, right, let's investigate this, guys. Come on, he said the White House? Okay, how do we get to the White House? And we need to get to that basement. It's just ridiculous. So that's what I'm starting to wonder, like, what is going on? Because we're all in a state of chaos and confusion and aggression and anger. And the thing that a lot of these people have in common is stories from Chris. So, but yes, so my experience with Jamie is with regards to this Oxy, I don't believe, first of all, going back to like the psychological aspect too, when you look at any family relationships, like, oh, we all have families that we can call all kinds of names, but we also have families that we love. And sometimes I've heard people say, you know, don't call me family because not all family is good family. So it's, there's no singular idea of what a family looks like. But as far as the discovery, what we were able to see, and also from some of the books that were later on written, was that obviously Chris and Jamie were never close. They were not close during their childhood and their upbringing. They, you know, Jamie was considered like the popular, rebellious type of teenager, whereas Chris was more isolated and by himself. So you can already see that for Jamie and Chris to be on some sort of level to even go to the to the lengths of conspiring to murder someone is highly unlikely, just based on their family dynamics and just knowing what we know about their family structure and their family high. Like, Jamie never even visited them in Colorado. So she never, they were out in Colorado for a couple of years and she never went to see them out in Colorado. So that tells you, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. It just tells you that they weren't close. The only time they saw each other was for birthdays and parties. So how then can we just jump on this idea that, you know, yeah, she must have conspired with him? It just doesn't make sense. It's not likely. It's not logical. It doesn't make sense. That's why I keep kind of leaning more towards we need to investigate just the extent of the influence, psychological influence that NK had over Chris, because again, I don't think that she would have physically caused harm to anyone, but I do think that a lot of the mental back and forth and the nonverbal communication between the two of them, even verbal, was probably very persuasive for Chris. So that's where I would kind of put my money on. But all the stuff that happened in North Carolina with Nutgate and everything like that, I think it played a significant part in it in terms of for Chris's head to just kind of to give him an additional reason to go through with what he was planning. But I don't believe that his family was involved in the plotting of it, you know, at least from what I've seen and from my experience from talking with the family, all of them. I asked Cindy as well, and I don't believe that the Oxy thing came from Chris's family. Now, I will say that the note that Chris allegedly left in North Carolina that was later found by Chris's sister, where he says, if something happens to me, investigate my wife. That note was also something that I asked Jamie and Cindy and Ronnie about. And they all, separately, of course, they all kind of, their stories aligned. And they talked about the day that Chris came over to his parents' house. They were all kind of hanging out. And Chris was on the phone a lot, obviously, texting back and forth with his mistress. So his mom, now this is from memory, but I'm paraphrasing, but his mom addressed it with him and said, hey, you know, you've been on your phone a lot. Have you, like, what's going on? Is there someone else? And he didn't respond directly to that question, but he did initiate the conversation about having decided to leave Shanann and that they were going through a separation. And that was a topic of conversation. And at this point, I think that Nutgate came up and it was talked about, and Cindy probably expressed some choice words about Shanann, because at that point, it was an overreaction, in my opinion, because, you know, obviously there's a lot of other relationship dynamics going on between Cindy and Shanann. So there's a lot more there. But in terms of just the Nutgate thing, I think that Shanann did overreact. And I think that part of what supports that is that Frankie had pistachios in his room as well. And he said that, you know, Shanann told me to put it away, like, you know, that it can't be out. And she gave me shit for it. So obviously, you know, it's there was something going on with the Nutgate. So Cindy then was telling Chris, like, you should have seen how angry she was. I'm afraid that if you walk away, that something bad might happen. And that's how the note came about. And it is kind of odd. But then again, at this point, the only person who knew what was going to happen is Chris. And who's to say that he didn't suggest that himself? So that's allegedly how the note was written. And she said that he got up, he walked to the kitchen, he wrote the note and put it in an envelope and sealed the envelope. And she said that no one read it. They didn't, like, pass it around and read it all, but he just wrote out whatever, sealed it and put it in the cabinet or whatever. But she said that she had no idea that he made that comment about the kids, that they were all shocked that he added that sentence about that part about I would never hurt my kids. So that to me suggests that he knew, obviously, like I said, he knew what he's doing, but not his family. So I think Simone, I think everybody exaggerated that whole situation. Okay, so that's the note. So there was that conversation. So again, RC. Sorry. It's not Jamie, in my opinion. There's nothing from all of the conversations that we had, the information that we dug through. There's nothing to suggest that there was any sort of conspiracy. I am aware that Cadel is saying that she has some sort of 100% proof or evidence. So, like I said, if she does, that's great. Take it to the police. But I do believe, I think I know what the evidence is that she has, because I think I've seen it as well. And it's not anything that is from the time of before, like, it's not anything from the time frame that would be helpful, basically. It's not anything from back in the day from the murders. It was something that was said after the murders and that was said to people who came in after the murders happened. So it's not I don't know. I would need to see more, but I don't think it's good enough. So, okay, I'm gonna look at chat now. I don't know if I'm missing anything. Let's see. If I'm missing anything, let me know, ladies. All right. Okay, I'm going to look at chat now. What is the evidence? The evidence that I've seen is a screenshot, quite frankly. And that's the evidence that I saw. In my opinion, Casby asks, in my opinion, was Cindy controlling? When? What do you mean was Cindy controlling? Can you be more specific? In terms of like the crime or? It's a beautiful day. What if, what if, what if? We can what if until, you know, whatever, but. The fact is, there. It's not a fact, I guess, but in my opinion, it was an overreaction. That's good, Sherry-Ann. I'm glad. If she is talking to the police, then good. But I don't think creating a circus on AD's thing, talking about, oh, I've got the clue, but I can't tell you. I gotta tell you. Ooh, you're not gonna believe this. You know, that kind of thing is really what upsets me, because that's the type of stuff that causes further damage to everybody involved. And, you know, regardless, if you want to believe that this was a whole conspiracy by the Watts and this is what happened, that's fine. But do it in a way so that it's not harming people. If Cadel has evidence, then Cadel can take that evidence to the CBI, to the FBI, to Weld, to Chicago police, to wherever she wants. She can go and have that taken care of. But when I start seeing things like circulating online, I really don't like that. I don't like that. I didn't like it when it was happening with Anna. I don't think Anna deserved anything that happened. And a lot of it was perpetrated by Kim, which is one of the main reasons why I walked away. I will not be affiliated with anything like that, with anyone who says that they remove people. So my first principle, this is not even professionally, but on a personal level, is to not do harm. And I can't sit around while people are, you know, caught like literally harming other people. And both Anna and Jamie have children who are completely innocent in this entire thing. And so every time that something like this happens, and every time that these rumors start, we've seen what happens with the families. I mean, the type of death threats and the type of messages and letters, physical letters that they get, is ridiculous. Julie, I do tell, that's part of, I tell everybody. That's why I came on. It's not up to me to tell people how to run their channels, but this is the only thing that I can do. I can give someone my opinion, and if they want to listen, they listen. If they don't, they don't. But I can't tell people how to live their lives. But I can come on here and tell you how I feel. So, oh, I'm sorry, Dandy, to hear that you had a heart attack. I'm so sorry. Yeah, I'll be quitting soon, so. It is a shit show. Simone is asking who Lana is. I honestly have no clue. See, these people have been around from the beginning, but I haven't really participated in any of those groups that people were in during those times in the very beginning. So I don't know who's who. But what I have seen was enough. Yeah, please don't bash anybody. Period. Like, there's no need to bash AD or any other creator. I don't care. Try to be civil. You can dislike someone. You don't have to be mean. Yeah, I don't know. I'm having a difficult time believing that anyone will be arrested, quite frankly. Well, at least not from what Cadel's talking about, is that's what I'm saying. I don't know about future or current investigations. No, Megan, I know you can disagree with AD, that's fine. But there's people saying that name calling, basically, you know what they love to say, crook con, this, that, and the other. And that's just not necessary. It puts me in an awkward position because I don't want to allow or encourage or participate in any of that stuff. I'm trying to find a picture that I want to show you guys too. 1 second. Yeah, there's you don't get arrested for giving someone Oxy. Like, I don't understand what the, you know, what the big deal is. Gianna, I am not trusting, but actually I'm not very trust, girl. I'm not trusting. I give everyone the benefit of the doubt. And that's kind of part of the human condition is that we all like it's ex like I said, it's expected to we're expected to come into co in some sort of conflict whenever you're dealing with other humans. So I understand that emotions can get in the way. I understand that people say things they don't mean, do things they don't mean, this, that, or the other. So I always like to give people the benefit of the doubt and to hear them out. And that's it. Sandy, yes, it is a felony to distribute opiates, but if someone gives someone else one oxy or whatever, that's not, I mean, you could technically go to jail, but I don't think that law enforcement would do this entire operation to bring someone down for giving one oxy to someone that, you know, that there's no evidence of a felony having taken place unless you have it on a recording or something, or someone talks. So, well, yeah, I mean, according to what Shanann is saying and the symptoms that she had, I do believe that he did give her Oxy, and I do believe that he did bring Oxy with him. I just don't think that he got it in North Carolina. I think he had it with him from coming in from Colorado. And Oxy obviously is, like I said before, now every time I say like I said, I think of you know who, and to stop saying that. Oxy is a controlled substance, and it's also one that's abused a lot. So it's not difficult to come by, especially not if you are affiliating and associating with individuals who would have easy access to that. And that individual would be NK. And the reason why I say that is because she has a history of not only substance abuse, but you know that your substance use is problematic, and getting to a point of full-blown addiction once you start getting arrested because of using substances. So very early on, when NK was younger, she was arrested twice for drunk driving. She was ordered rehab. All of her friends have been in rehab or have struggled with addictions. I know that there's some connections between NK and Trent Bolt or whatever, and he's on the fentanyl patches. So there's plenty of acquaintances in Colorado who could have helped Chris get opiates. Dr. Hopping is also something that happens a lot. Yeah, but the thing, Dr. Watson says, it's a felony to distribute, far greater charge as accomplice to death of a fetus. That I agree with that. But in this case, no one died directly as a result of the Oxy. As a matter of fact, it's not even in the autopsy or the toxicology, so it's completely irrelevant. And if there were to be any arrests, like Ms. Cadel says, you know, I would think that they would be because, I mean, they wouldn't be because of murder, nor would they reach the level of attempted murder even, nor would they even reach the level of conspiracy to commit murder or any felony. So that's what I'm saying. It's irrelevant at this point, unless Cadel has a video recording of Jamie giving Chris the Oxy on August 6th of 2018, which yeah, and it isn't even clear whether it's OxyContin or oxycodone, but I I want to pull something up because I think I looked at this. Obviously went down multiple rabbit holes, but I'm pretty okay with where I'm at in terms of the Oxy and my theory. Like I just think it at this point it's not relevant. Like there are other questions that are more pressing, in my opinion. Another thing that was used as evidence for, used in support of the idea that Jamie is the one who gave the oxy and this, that, and the other, was that because of Jamie's profession. Jamie works as a respiratory therapist, and she works like, I don't know what the term is for it, but she sees patients in the community. So I don't think that she has a safe full of opiates on her at all times. And I don't know that, I'm not sure what the job descriptions and are of a respiratory therapist, and if they even have the authorization to distribute or prescribe controlled substances. I'm trying to think, am I forgetting anything? Do you guys have any other questions with clearing rumors up? Because I can't think of anything right now. I just wanted to make sure that I put out here what I found when I dug into this. And I went straight to the source because I don't like to run around. So. And I told you how our communication was established from the beginning. I asked for transparency and just honesty. And whenever there were inconsistencies, we did address it. I never felt that I couldn't approach her with a question. And I hope that she felt the same way. But I think that can be put to rest, and I would hate to see history repeat itself again, because quite frankly, a lot of the effects of the first time that this whole thing came up were pretty devastating. I'm afraid, like, I don't want to say too much because I do want to respect the privacy of our conversations, but I will say that, you know, some of the effects were devastating, psychological effects, but also physical effects. And to the point where I'm the last time I spoke with the family, I was starting to have concerns for Cindy's health, to be quite honest, because all of this, the shit that's going on right now, and that's not getting better. It's only getting worse. I think is really having a negative effect on people's lives to the point where I don't feel comfortable with any of this. So. I honestly am concerned for Cindy's health. I am. And they do, you know, from what we know from the discovery and everything, you know, they do have a family history of depression and things like that. And it's not... Yeah, why would he go? Yeah, it doesn't make sense. So, Renee, I actually, through my communication with the family, I have also gotten to communicate with Chris Watts himself as well, and I did address some of those issues with him. Unfortunately, before I could get anywhere with him, that's when Kim Chair popped up, and that's when I walked away. But from what I did get from him, he is aware of what this is doing to his family. But he's also not doing anything to stop it, which is also what I told him. So, and I also asked him, I asked him straight up, I said, are you aware that your sister is being accused of attempted murder? Like, are you aware of this? HCN, what did you call her? What do you mean? Who? Yeah, I don't think he cares. I really don't think he cares. I don't think he has compassion or empathy. Yes, I called her Kim Chair because I watch Crafton's channel and he kind of does these satires, and he renamed Kim to Kim Chair in the detectiving, and it's freaking hilarious. So it's stuck in my head. So I always, I don't know, it comes out. And he has these little sound bites that he plays of her most commonly used phrases. So every time I say it now, I think of her, which is good because it'll get me to stop saying fillers or at least reduce them. Yes, cooperate. Whoever is blaming Cindy for this, I don't agree. I don't agree that Cindy, from my experience again, I don't agree that she would have that much power over Chris to drive him to the point of murder, because he was glad to not be in contact with her for years. For years. You know, and I don't think they were as close as people think, because it's, you know, from the beginning, he's saying that Ronnie is his hero and Shanann knows that or knew that as well. So there's all this evidence that the bond between Chris and Ronnie was obviously stronger than between Chris and Cindy. So I don't think that in his hierarchy, in his mind, that Cindy would even have that much power over Chris. I think Chris is the only one to blame here for his actions. What led up to that moment, if it wasn't for the psychological games that him and his mistress got into, I don't think that this would have happened. I don't think that this would have happened if Shanann didn't go away for 5 weeks, or I don't even think it would have happened if they went away together for that amount of time. But I think those 5 weeks, 5.5 weeks is what probably had the most impact on his decision to do this. Vanessa, if he put the crushed up Oxy inside of her balance pill, then she wouldn't taste it because it would be in a capsule. But if he gave it to her in her Thrive shake, and I tested Thrive as well, guys. So, and the shakes, you know, they're good, but they do have kind of like that chalky, not in a bad way though, but the consistency is kind of odd. So I don't think that you could taste it. So here's my thing, Turquoise. Turquoise said, I feel bad for Cindy until she just wouldn't show any compassion for Shanann, and she just kept saying mean things about Shanann. Let me see. I don't think that Cindy is resenting Shanann or is glad that this happened or that any of those things. I don't believe that. As a matter of fact, I think that I've listened to her cry many times for Shanann. She has a memorial in her garden for Shanann, and she does, how do I say this? She's desperate for the truth because she's aware that Shanann's, obviously they didn't get along. They didn't like each other. Shanann had a strong personality. She had her own way of doing things. Cindy had hers. That's nothing unusual. They had Nutgate happen. All of the past disagreements came forward because there was a lot of social media going back and forth, and Shanann was yelling and then screaming at Cindy. So, was she mad at her? Of course. Did she have an opinion about her behavior during this whole time? Of course. Is she entitled to think how whatever happened and why it happened? Yes. You know, as a matter of fact, with this whole Nutgate situation, my understanding is that Cindy wasn't even in the vicinity of where this ice cream was taken out of. So it's like, for Shanann, for example, to say, you wanted to kill my daughter, when Cindy wasn't even in the kitchen when this happened. So it's exaggerated. It's emotional. It's an argument. And it's disrespectful. It's disrespectful. And if I hosted my own sister and my own nephew, and my own sister tried to tell me that I try to do something my nephew, I would show her the goddamn door. You know what I mean? Like, there would be a lot more. You would be hearing a lot from me. So right now, Shanann can't defend herself. I agree. But I also don't think that I've ever heard Cindy say that Shanann killed anyone. Never. She never said that. And the other thing about Cindy that I want to make clear is I began talking to Cindy almost 2 years ago, actually, 2 years ago. And she has consistently always maintained that she wants to know the truth. Always. And she says that if Chris did this, then he is where he needs to be. He is where he deserves to be. But I won't stop loving him, and shouldn't blame her for that because he's her son. But she needs to know the truth because nobody can heal this way. So that has been Cindy's claim from the very beginning. However, can you imagine having someone as aggressive and as sales-oriented as, you know, the spokesperson? I feel like with Cindy's state of mind and her personality and her I guess she's just as suggestible as Chris is. So, and it wouldn't surprise me if for the past 2 years, you know, all Cindy has been hearing from part of her circle of friends is that, well, his first confession is the only confession that you should listen to. And a lot of the interviews, the interview that people dislike Cindy for, and a couple of other things that came out that are just completely unrealistic in how they portrayed Cindy, were all actually organized by Kim. And that's something that I was told by Kim herself. That the interview with ABC or whatever that interview was set up by Kim and her reporter friend. So that tells me that from the beginning, it was like, I can prove that he didn't do it and it's blah, blah, blah. And she did this and you have to make sure to advocate for your son so that people know what kind of person she was. I can see that. Right, hybrid? Yeah. Annette says, why doesn't Cindy get rid of Kim? So that's part of the problem. That's actually another conversation that, multiple conversations that I've had with the family. And anytime that someone leaked something online or something happened. I remember like the video visits and then the call that Jay for Justice released, all of those little dramas. You know, I did address directly with them and I asked, why don't you just get rid of these people who are, you know, doing these things to you? How can you expect for anything to move forward when the very people who are in your own circle are leaking things that are harming you? It doesn't make sense to me. And frankly, the response that I got was that, you know, Kim has been there from the very beginning. So literally, like, they hadn't even found the bodies yet of Shanann, Belen, Cece, and Nico. Kim was already in their lives. So she was in there from the very beginning. And she's been the only consistent person over time that's been there for them. And she's gained their trust over time, while at the same time, she's gained control over, as she's gained trust, she's also, in my opinion, whether consciously or subconsciously, gained control over Cindy, because there was nothing that Cindy could do without Kim's approval. And I wish somebody would try to argue that or say that it's a lie, because I personally went through a situation where I've witnessed it myself. So I know for a fact that a lot of the issues and a lot of the reasons why we're still nowhere, we haven't moved anywhere in this case, is because, in my opinion, again, whether consciously or subconsciously, everything was going through Kim. Everything. And it was pretty much, it was pretty much her shots. And she can say, you know, that nothing is without the permission of the Watts, and they all give her permission and she's good to go and she's cool to do everything that she needs to do, blah, blah, blah. She can say that all she wants, but it's also not difficult to get hostages to say whatever you want them to say. Pumped Up Kicks, does Cindy ever comment on YouTube? I don't know. I don't think she has. I think she had Facebook for a while, but I think she's deleted that as well now. So, but I don't think she has a YouTube account. Thank you, Heather, so much. Well, hostages. I mean that was an analogy. Like, she gets Ronnie and Cindy to talk on her channel and Chris. Like, Chris sounded like a hostage in that recording. I just want to say, armchair hurt my feelings. And please, you know, it's like, God, how embarrassing, dude. Okay, we're not going to wish death upon anyone, Missy, so I'm going to remove your comment. Yes, Stephanie, I agree. In 2 years, she hasn't done anything positive for them, but she's removed a lot of good people from their lives. I agree with that. Tina, yeah, she watches. She does. I know that she does watch YouTube, because there have been times when she would send me a text message in response to a video that I would make or something like that. So I know that she watches, but I don't know whether or not, like, she comments on videos and whether or not, like, she has a channel or anything like that. That's the part that I don't know. Annette asked me if I can get, I can't get anyone. That's one thing that I never, ever want to find myself doing, is telling people who to talk to and who not to talk to, who to be friends with and who not to be friends with. That was important for me, especially when communicating with Jamie and Cindy and everyone, is to let them know that I'll tell you my opinion about what I see is happening, but ultimately, like, it's their choice whether or not they want to continue to have that person in their life. And I know that right now, Actually, I don't know right now because I haven't been in contact with them for a while now. But I know that last time when Kim first came out and when all of this started happening, I know that Jamie was not on board with this, but she didn't feel like she was heard. And I thought that was very low. And that was another reason that I walked away, is because it's just bizarre. It's so bizarre that you would disregard someone asking you not to do something, not to invade their privacy, and they completely disregard that. Yeah, Kim met them after the fact. But that's another reason why I also asked Kim if she wants to come on, so that we can address all of these things, because those are some questions that I would like to clarify as well, especially in terms of the discovery and her theory. Like, I heard her saying... I heard her saying that I forgot. Did she know the Watts before this? No. Yeah, I lost it. I forgot what I was gonna say. Oh, yes, I heard her saying that she, with the way that she presented her evidence, even, and her theory, and I heard her saying that, you know, she has the right to her theory, she has the right to her opinion, she has the right to say whatever she wants, blah, blah, blah. Sure, she does. But she also says we a lot. We this, we that. Cindy this, and it, like, she speaks for the family. She doesn't speak for herself. So that's one thing. And if she's speaking for the family, of course, that's not going to reflect positively or even neutrally on the family. It's gonna cause a lot of backlash. And I don't think it's fair for her to prioritize for this family when Jamie doesn't agree with this, and her kid, like, she wants to protect her children and her own family, and, you know, it's a complete disregard of what's with the flying monkeys. Am I forgetting anything? Any other questions? Like, this is your time to ask me anything. I will literally tell you from if I've had any conversations with anyone about it, I'll tell you what I know. But Cat Lady, do I know if KK is a friend of NK? No, I don't know that. It wouldn't surprise me. SoCal, yeah, it could be. I mean, who knows? Yeah, that's odd. That's an yeah. What SoCal asked about the deflection whenever NK comes up, and that's something that I don't understand because they're claiming that, you know, the pings, it was just her going home and there's nothing to indicate that NK was involved, and she just doesn't want to talk about it. She shuts it down. But then there are other parts of the discovery that she, in my opinion, distorts and reaches way into the galaxy in terms of putting things together. But those are somehow more plausible than the freaking ping that didn't ping anywhere else but a mile away from his house. So. Julie, I don't know if the Watts were in 80s Live. I don't think I saw that or watched that live, so I'm not aware of anything. Yeah, please. You can call me Natasha, that's fine. Dr. Watson asked, does Jamie believe that the Heartless One killed all four? I would say that yes, she does. Well, I want to say yes. I'll say that she fluctuates. It depends. She believes it sometimes. Other days, it's more difficult for her to accept that. But I think that Jamie has accepted it more so than her parents. And I think that's where a lot of her conflict comes in from, is seeing her parents struggle with this. So, but I know that, yeah, I know that for Jamie, I think that she's farther along. Blue bag. Do you know anything about the blue bag? What blue bag? As Jamie clarified for her father, never mind. Was retracted. I know, Gianna, that is that's the part that I can never. Jojo, I believe that's a possibility that, I mean, at this point, it's not even a question whether or not some of the behaviors that NK engaged in after the murders were definitely felonies, like lying to federal agents, obstructing justice, giving false information. All of those are crimes that are punishable, and obviously she wasn't charged with anything. So one possibility could be that she copped some sort of a deal with the prosecutor for immunity if she, in return, gives them a whole account of whatever she knows. And if that were the case, then I think that would also maybe explain a little bit better why she was so well protected and insulated, if you will, throughout this whole ordeal. Because I don't think, I mean, some of the questions that we have are not difficult to answer. And the fact that Weld County is allowing this online circus to go on rather than releasing supplemental records to shut everyone up like they have in the past. I mean, they've released all of the calculator pictures after the fact, like they released them 5-6 months after the first discovery came out. So Shannon Williams, the mystery accomplice is, I don't think there's a mystery accomplice. I don't think there's a mystery anywhere. Exactly, Carolyn. Patrick Frazee's case is an example. You know, his mistress was a cleanup lady and she got out of it scot-free. Maddie D wants to know why NK freaked out at police talking to Jim. Well, my first thought is she doesn't want them to talk to Jim because she doesn't want to hear. She doesn't want Jim to say anything. She doesn't want Jim to, she doesn't want to get caught in the lies, because at this point, God knows what she told agents, that, for example, no one knew about her and Chris, that they were never out in public. But come to find out, not only were they out in public, they went to movies together, they went camping together. I believe that they were with Jim at the sand dunes, at least for part of the time or some of the time, because Kobach made it clear in one of the phone interviews where he says, there's a picture of a guy with a beard and a backpack. And she was like, yeah, that's Jim. So that would have been immediately. I mean, she would have been caught up in a lie. She even lied about her friend Danielle. So there's a friend that she has who works in Montana, I believe. And the night of, was it the 11th or the 9th? That Friday night, I think, is when this Danielle person came out of town, and they went, NK and her friend Danielle went to a Rockies game and then went out drinking afterwards, and she spent the night. But in her interview, she didn't refer to her as Danielle. She referred to her as Daniel, like in a male, as a male. So she's clearly like putting an effort into concealing and hiding and not giving out information that could identify people that police would want to question. Okay, Dr. Watson is saying, has Jamie clarified for her father that Nico is his grandchild? For the family to insinuate that the child is not is evil. Jamie, that's not up to Jamie, first of all, to clarify whose child Nico was. I don't think that's Jamie's role. I think that this whole debacle with the DNA is also something that's stirred up by people like Kim, who have these different connections and different ideas about different evidence. And I think that she can sound pretty convincing, especially to the family, who are in denial already about the tragedy that has happened, but who'd also kind of almost subconsciously want it to be true, if that makes sense. Like, I'm not saying that this is a deliberate thing, but it's a human condition. Doe Jane is asking if Jamie's distancing herself from her family. I don't think that she's distancing herself from her family, but I do think that she is trying to distance herself from social media. Oz Woman, has it been confirmed that a woman entered the Watts home? Yes, that's in a police report. That's in a police report. And Nate reported this and said that he has it on camera, but none of that footage was released. Ruth says that apparently I said that the Oxy didn't have any effect on her. I don't remember saying that. I agree. I don't know where Nate went. Everybody moved out of the neighborhood and no one is really willing to talk to anyone. And yeah, it's annoying. Oh, Loopy Lou asked, what do you think about what they said about Bella walking up the stairs? Okay, I cannot tell you how much that enraged me because, oh my God, that the way that it was presented, first of all, is nauseating to me. But second of all, if this story could get any worse, I swear, like, you don't need that extra detail to make this story any worse than it already is. I think that's I've never seen anything to suggest that she walked up the stairs, so I think that's a lie. I think that's stolen either from Reddit or from a dream or wherever, but I don't think that's reality. I suppose it could be true, but there's no indication that Bella was alive right before she went in the tank. Oz Woman says, how would it change the case if Nico was not Chris Watts' baby? I don't think it would change the case. I mean, the case is done. It's over with. I think the only thing that the baby thing could potentially impact or influence is possibly like the motive or whatever was going on in the relationship between Shanann and Chris that she didn't tell her friends, because there are a couple of things that are kind of odd in the discovery that just seem out of place. For example, the attorney that Shanann met with and talked with when she asked about divorce and all those topics. And then there was also the person at the hairdressing salon or whatever, where Shanann's mom works. She, a worker there gave an interview saying that, oh yeah, you know, Chris and Shanann were going through a separation. Their marriage was over. Like, she was talking about it as if everyone knew that it's a normal thing. So I guess that's the only thing, like, that their relationship wasn't as perfect as it seemed, but it really wouldn't change the case at all. So what? So let's say that it was someone else's, which I don't know. I don't think it is. I think when the DA told him it's Chris's baby, it was Chris Watts' baby. There was no other Chris in the file that the DA would know of other than Chris Watts. So I think that's pretty clear. But if she did, or, you know, have a baby by someone else, or even an affair, period, it wouldn't change anything other than just that piece of information. It wouldn't surprise me, actually, because, I mean, just in terms of relationships, first of all, it's sad that up to 70% of marriages in the United States end in divorce. So it's sad that, you know, 3 out of 10 marriages don't end in divorce. So it's like, it's a sad statistic. So it wouldn't be unheard of if they were having some difficulties. So that's, I don't think that's a big deal, but I don't know why. Yeah, I don't know why it would make a difference, why it's even being brought up by Kim. And in the matter that it was, too, I thought it was very disrespectful to kind of blackmail the Rusek family to, if you don't respond to this, that means that you're agreeing that it wasn't Watts's. Did you hear that? Oh my gosh, I was shocked when I heard that. Yeah, shady lady. I'm not saying that she did have an affair. I'm saying if she did, it wouldn't be anything out of the norm. Yeah, that's right, Renee. There's a part when he was playing phone tag with Frederick Police Department. I think it was on either Monday night or Tuesday night. I can't remember. Monday night, I think. Yeah. He was on the phone. He was on the phone with NK on his personal phone. And the officer kept calling him and kept getting disconnected. And finally, Chris called him back from his work phone. So that he could, and then lied and said, oh, my phone isn't working or whatever, which that's a lie because he was on the phone with NK on his personal phone. Isn't that crazy? Like she was on the phone while he was on the phone with the police. Mickey, I'm not sure. I never really looked into that, but I would assume it's because of the state that they were discovered in and a level of decomposition. Yeah. I agree, shady lady, that it's always gets me when neither Chris or NK can remember their 111-minute phone calls. So, Yeah, Stephanie, thank you. It's really important. You know, we've had many conversations about this, but it's really important for me to clarify, put out the facts and the evidence that I know would put to rest some of the misinformation that's going around, because that's the most infuriating part for me, is the misinformation and then the effects of that, the harm that it causes. It's okay to speculate and to look into things, but you know, taking it a step further and actually going out of your way to try to harm someone is scary. There's all kinds of personalities and people on the internet, and you never know. Thank you, Shannon. That's what I strive for, is to keep it as close to truth as possible with what we have, with what we have at our disposal. Yes, we all have our own opinions, but you can't have an opinion on a fact, right? So that's where I get frustrated, is the facts that we know are now all of a sudden getting twisted and do I think any other Anadarko employees were involved? Oh, shoot. I don't think that any other Anadarko employees were involved. I know there's a lot of chatter around Troy McCoy and his involvement. Oh, Stephanie, thank you so much. Yeah, there's speculation about Troy McCoy and his involvement, and there's some questions about his truck, GPS, and the ranch, and just the fact that he went out there a second time. So yeah, there are some questions that have led people to go down that path. But I've listened to Troy's interview. I've read, obviously, like, the Discovery Inside and Out. I've interacted with Troy McCoy as well after the fact. And I don't believe that he was involved specifically, and I don't believe that there was anyone else from Anadarko that would have been involved. I think for Troy, I think he had, you know, he was a little bit like sarcastic and funny. He has a dry sense of humor. He's a gamer, so I don't know if that helps in terms of understanding personality, but I don't see any antisocial indications anywhere throughout the Discovery, or even in my interactions with him, that would indicate that he would be capable of anything like that. I don't believe that whatsoever. I think the extent to what he might have known was not probably, but he may have known about NK or suspected something about NK. But I don't think that he participated or did anything to contribute to what happened. They did visit Troy when they found out that he was there on Tuesday morning, And he did admit to not telling them the truth, basically. But he said that he went back there because he wanted to check it out to see if he could find anything, because he knew that Chris was there first thing in the morning. He was there by himself for a while, because Troy is actually, I think, the last one who, he was the last one to get there from all of the coworkers that morning. So I think he said that he went back there to see if he can find anything, and he lied that he went out to look for a wrench. But he really wanted to see if there's anything out there. And he came across a water truck pumper person. And this person was actually emptying one of the tanks, which is weird. I find it odd that no one talks about this, but I think it's actually quite significant that on Tuesday when Troy went back, there was a water truck there, and that water truck was emptying the tank that Bella was in. And it was describing the process of what it was doing. So it was putting water in and sucking oil. I don't know how that works, but I don't know. I just always thought that was kind of significant, because, yeah, I think that at one point in the interrogation, they asked Chris, you know, or someone somewhere said that they were supposed to check the tanks a week after that Monday. And so why even do that if they were going to find them anyways? But, and that Chris, you know, said, I don't know. I don't know why I would do it. But that, like, they wouldn't have found them. That's the thing. Like, when they empty the tanks, they don't, like, go inside. They just stick a hose, and it does its thing. There's a pump or whatever, however that works. So I don't know that they would have found them necessarily, unless they literally, like, for some reason, emptied the tanks and went inside, which I don't see them doing that. The only thing that I did hear or see somewhere in Discovery too is that they were going to get rid of Survey 319 because it's one of the older sites, and they were going to shut it down, take it out of production or whatever. And so if they ever dismantled it, I wonder if they would have found them that way. But I don't think that they would have found them just by doing whatever they need to do with the tanks and the pumps and all that stuff. Yeah, if the hoses got clogged for some reason, I'm sure that that would cause some sort of suspicion, but I don't know how that would work. What's that, SoCal? I've heard Larry once on a live, and I think he talks sense. Yeah, Larry is more than welcome to come on whenever and reach out and do all that stuff. Yeah, I would love to talk to him, because I think from what I've heard, he does have a lot of knowledge regarding just the whole court stuff. And I think he would help put together, not put together, but help with the files and everything that we were told when we went to Frederick. Bobby Williams, that's a good question. What was in the toilet in CW's house and the toilet door was locked? Now, about the locking part, I don't know, because they said that they lock the toilets because of the Vaseline that the girls would get their hands on and make a mess. But as far as the toilet goes, I don't know. But something that was wondered about is the shirt that Shanann was wearing when she walked into the house has not been recovered. It's not in discovery. It hasn't been collected. So there has been speculation about that shirt possibly being stuck down there. Why it would be down there, I don't know. But some theories suggest that to conceal blood, possibly, but I have no idea. I agree, DocuMax. There was something about Bella that she was just an old soul. You can tell by her eyes. I don't know. And see, these are some of the questions that I was hoping to get answers for once I started talking to Chris, but with everything that has been going on, I realized that the truth is never going to come from Chris, that the only way that we can get any answers to any questions is to strictly focus on getting the rest of the discovery. And that's where I think Larry can help, because I did draft up a whole appeal for Weld County. So I don't know, maybe it would be interesting to go over it on a live with him. I wouldn't want to pursue that anymore because, like I said, I don't have the energy for this case anymore, but I'm willing to share whatever I have with the right people, of course, because it has been so time consuming to type that up because I'm not an attorney and it was. Yeah. Thank you, Stephanie. Yeah, I think there are a couple of items in the discovery that I think would be easier to obtain without putting up a fight, too much of a fight, because there's literally no reason for them to hold him back. And one of them would be the the video recorded interview of NK with her dad at the Thornton Police Department. That has no reason to be withheld. And the argument that it's not that they're protecting her privacy or whatever is not valid because they've released the audio with all of their information in it. We know Dwayne Kessinger's date of birth, his phone number, his address, you know, all of that was released unredacted. So I don't see what the video portion of that very interview would be releasing. So I think that would be easy to get with a little bit of a push. And the other thing that I think would be easy to get is the footage from Nate's camera that he gave to Dave Baumhover, I think on this is from memory, I might get this wrong, but I think it was like October 26th or something like that. Baumhover wrote a report that Nate did give him USB stick with the footage where he says he saw Chris walk out of the side of the house and walked his parked car on the street. So I think those two things would be relatively easy to get. It's the phone dumps that I think is going to be a little bit more difficult, but I think there's a way, I guess. Megan, I think that I don't know the answer for that, but I think that before we went to Frederick, I don't know if you remember, but I'm sure that Weld County was bombarded with emails, including the district attorney. Like, I was even getting these messages saying that there's a surprise waiting for me when I go to Frederick, and that when I get to Frederick, I'm never gonna leave or something like that. Like, there are all kinds of silly messages I was getting. So I think that that had something to do with it. Because initially, what I was told by Amanda that I would get, none of that was in the actual release that I got. So, and when I asked her, she didn't have an answer other than to say that I need to talk to the district attorney's office. Yeah, she went from... I have all of the emails that I've showed before, but when I asked her, because the discovery in full was close to $2,500, and we did a fundraising, so all of us raised those funds to get those files. But yeah, before we did raise those funds, I told her, you know, I don't want to go through all of this unless I can somehow know that what we're looking for will be in those files. And she did tell me that there would be, I think she said like 77 CDs or something like that. But then like the day before I was to pick it up, she said, oh, never mind, it's not 77 CDs, now it's 11. So a bunch of the stuff that she initially said I would be able to obtain was now cut short. So that's that. And then I got a letter from the chief of police. That I have shared before. Actually, I can share it now again. Let me just find it because you can see how it doesn't make sense really. And then I think after we look at the letter, I can kind of wrap it up. But it is. Megan. That's the price that she gave me. She was the one that gave me what it would cost. She gave me the whole breakdown of it. And still didn't get them. Okay, I'll share this screen. Oh my gosh, this is so slow now. Okay. Let me know if you can see this. Thank you, hybrid. Yeah, so this is a letter that I got. They said, after receiving your records, the request was... Okay, after receiving your records, pursuant to the Open Records Act, the request was discussed thoroughly between the Frederick Police Department and the Weld County District Attorney's Office and weighed against state statute that dictates inspection and release of records. The records, the requests included case reports, contact history, copy of audio video, phone record, per additional email correspondence, meaning I listed everything that I wanted from them, including where the hell it was located in their evidence locker, like spelled it all out for them. So they're saying, while your request is made pursuant to the Open Records Act, it's more appropriate for the Criminal Justice Records Act. Okay. So then he goes on to say the criminal justice records are defined as, okay, that's the definition. And then a custodian of any criminal justice record may deny inspection of such records on the ground that the disclosure would be contrary to the public interest. So then he goes on to say, it has been determined that under the circumstances present here, which I don't know what circumstances they're referring to, the Frederick Police Department will not release requested item number 4, which is the phone records, on the ground that disclosure would be contrary to public interest. And then they cite this case. Or this opinion says, address the issue of whether and under what circumstances the Criminal Justice Records Act requires disclosure of records of official actions by criminal justice agencies. So basically he goes on to say that, the phone records are not in public interest, but they will give me whatever else. So they listed here what they did release. And he says the district attorney's office release does include reports from assisting agencies such as the CBI and the FBI. So that's that. So they're saying that, you know, we can't have the phone records because it's not in the public interest, which we all know that's BS, but what they didn't address is the video, the interview of NK, and what they didn't address is the surveillance from Nate. So that's not part of a phone record, so that should have been released, but it wasn't. And when I asked again, I was told to go to talk to the district attorney's office, who never responded to my requests. So So there's that. So that's what I wrote my response to. But hi, Miss Menza. Welcome. Okay, Bobby, let's not name call, please. Yeah. So he says items 2 through 4 can be released with any necessary redactions. So that's the bunch, that's the all of the Home Depot footage that we got and all of the McDonald's footage that we got that wasn't in the initial release. So that's something. Yeah, Donna, I understand why it has to go through Weld County District Attorney. I just don't understand why they try to use this blanket statement for the denial of records by saying that it would be contrary to public interest. And actually, one of the case laws, when I was working on the response to this, I looked up all of the statutes and cases that they referenced. And actually, the statute does say that you cannot use a blanket statement such as it would be contrary to public interest, that it does have to be more specific. So yes, it's contrary to public interest because of such and such, but they never provided that other part. So and that, yes, there's a bunch of there's a McDonald's right off of the expressway in Frederick where the phone towers are, but also they have cameras, obviously. And so part of the release that we got in the records was all of that footage from McDonald's. And it's a lot of footage. And I haven't even like scratched the surface of that footage, but yeah, we do have that. And we also have a bunch of footage from Home Depot, both of the Home Depots actually. And yeah, we tried to look for Chris on that footage anywhere because he was at Home Depot on the Saturday of the Lazy Dog Saturday. He was there, purchased something for $10 and some cents. And yeah, we did a group thing where we try to go through all the footage because there's so much, but I don't think we ever came across anything. But I also don't think that we looked at everything too, so. So interestingly, in the live that I did hear Larry on, he was talking about, he was saying to look into whoever the district attorney was before what's his name, Rourke, and the person who was the district attorney is now a congressman. And basically, when you look into, when you dig a little bit deeper in that aspect, then you can begin to see that that could be a potential link there too, that you know, Rourke maybe anticipates, you know, moving on up to Congress. So it goes deep. But yeah, so basically, just to sum it up real quick, I came on here because I was upset with the rumors that are starting to go around about this mysterious accomplice and these arrests that are going to be made and blah, blah, blah. And I can already see that it's heading in the same direction where it was heading a year ago, that Jamie is ultimately in some way, shape, or form going to be pinned for this Oxy thing. So I came on to say that there's not any evidence of anything with Oxy. First of all, Shanann or the kids did not die as a result of opiate overdose or anything like that. So there's no reason for the Oxy to even be a conversation. Secondly, from my experience with in talking with Jamie herself about Oxy and about other issues that came up in the case, and also my experience in talking with Cindy and my experience in speaking with Ronnie, and even the little bit that I did have a chance to hear from Chris, did not indicate, well, although Chris's word obviously is not really significant or meaningful because he lies, but I don't believe that there was anything shady going on with the Oxy. And I think that it's causing a lot of damage and a lot of pain to people who don't deserve it. And especially Jamie's children, because no child, they didn't have any control over the family that they were going to be born into. They didn't choose the family that they're going to be born into, and it's not fair for those kids to be exposed to vitriol just because someone believes some BS on the internet. So that's the reason why I came on. And actually, if you guys, honestly, like I told you, I stepped away. I haven't been watching, following, and there's just too much going on. But if there's ever any questions that you guys have and anything about the discovery that you might find odd or some just anything that you might want to know, feel free to reach out to me. Feel free to email me. Feel free to message me. I might not get away or get back to you right away. I'll do my best to put everything together and to answer to the best of my ability, because I'm tired of the rumors. So if there's any rumors or questions or whatever that might be going on and you want to kind of set the record straight, feel free to reach out to us and ask any questions, and we'll answer them to the best of our ability with receipts, with whatever. So feel free to reach out, but you know, don't believe everything that you hear. Use critical thinking. Try to look. I know that the discovery is extensive and that not everybody has the time or the patience or the attention to sit through and read through all of that and watch all of the footage and listen to all the interviews and, you know, analyze everything. I know that a lot of people don't have time for that. That's why I'm telling you can come to me, because we've spent hours upon hours going through the discovery. We can almost cite the page numbers of the different reports and everything. So there are channels that you know that you can trust with that, Unmasked being one of them. So whenever you'd have any questions or anything with regards to the facts of the case, you can reach out to, I'll put my email in here. Yeah. So yeah, that's pretty much that's pretty much my two cents on all of this. So, and spread the word too. I mean, if you see people getting out of hand with these, I mean, actually, don't even bother. I don't even know. It's just frustrating, and I don't think there's anything really that we can do other than educate ourselves and just, you know, keep our side of the street clean. Miss Benzo says, I think Jamie's connected some of the attackers. I'm not falling for her routine at all anymore. Yeah, I mean, depends on who some of the attackers are that you are referring to, but I do know that there are some people in Jamie's circle who don't necessarily act in her or her family's best interest. So I don't know how much of that is deliberate on Jamie's part to keep them around. But again, in my experience, I don't think it's anything sinister. I just think that they're keeping, I mean, these are people that they trust now, and it's kind of scary. Well, not so much Jamie, but it's complicated, and I really don't want to name other people, so, but yeah. Yeah, Menzo, that's true. A lot of people get doxxed and attacked, and I don't think Jamie wants for anyone to be harassed. And I don't think it's her personally that's doing things like that. There's trolls that are relentless who are also embedded in this story. But yeah. Yeah. I'm not aware of that, Miss Menzo, but I did actually have one or two conversations about you, about your channel, with Jamie, and she has not said anything that would suggest that she dislikes you or is after you or anything like that. Yeah, that's ridiculous that this family was conspiring a murder. I was watching the chaos in 2018. There's way too many people and motives, and slushy ball, no one is getting arrested. Oh my God. Oh God, I needed that. Thank you. It's funny. Oh my gosh. All right, guys. Well, yes, Stephanie, thankfully. I mean, I am getting less harassed, quote unquote, but I do still get fake privacy strikes or complaints on everything that I put up on YouTube, regardless of what the topic is, what it's about. And whoever is doing this is doing it from my own email, which is odd. So, yeah, so there's someone who's determined, but it's whatever. It is what it is. But yeah, so whatever happens, however crazy this gets, I think the one grounding anchor, the anchor for me has always been the evidence that we have. And so no matter what you hear, if it sounds crazy, it probably is. So are there going to be arrests 2 years later for something that Cadle dug up out of somewhere? And Cadle hasn't been in contact with Chris for a year at all. Cadle hasn't been in contact with the Watts family at all since this debacle happened. Cadle didn't even have permission to do whatever she did with the second book. So for her to now all of a sudden have this evidence that she didn't have before that's going to lead to some arrests is... Yeah. So just think about it. Use your logic. So yes, I'm going to get off now. Thank you for listening to me, and thank you for coming on. Also, thank you to the mods, everyone who was here. Thanks for participating in the discussion. And like I said, feel free to reach out to me with any questions that you have, and hopefully we can come back with Larry and address some of those political issues surrounding this discovery. Because yeah, we're not going to get the answer from Chris, obviously. So I think the evidence is where our attention should be at. So that's that. Thank you for listening, and I hope you all have a great night.